Whenever we are going to construct a new line, railway line, or any road is to be constructed, then definitely it is required to cross the bridges. That bridge is to be constructed across the bridges. For any linear project, we have to maintain the level and the lines. So definitely it is required to construct the bridge for any linear project. Superstructure may be in the form of the cable state bridge, or you can say PLC, or you can say the fabricated bridges, or maybe the arch bridges. But common to all these bridges, we have to decide out how long this bridge is to be constructed. And how long is to be constructed, it will depend on the design discharge. How frequent we are going to compromise that the water will run over the bridge, and we are ready to compromise for the interruption of the traffic. So there is some term is called the recurrence period. That is the probable occurrence of the flood. So that is the concept behind how we are ready to compromise it. So there was one committee was constructed in 1959. That is the committee of the engineers that was headed by Mr. Khosla. And they decided that for the bridges which is to be constructed for the railway and for the road, that probable occurrence of the flood should be around the 50 years. So generally when we are talking about the design discharge, that is basically we are working out the discharge which may occur once in the 50 years. If when we are not able to provide a sufficient opening for the bridges, then it may result into the breach. And generally breaches occurs just behind the bridges, just near to the bridges. As the bridges are almost definitely it is the lowest point where the water is just crossing the embankment, and possibility of stagnated water will be there near to the bridge. And when we are not able to provide the sufficient opening, that will result into the breach in the embankment. So it is very important before starting the construction for the railway line and for the roadway, we have to decide how big bridge is to be constructed. There are some examples of the breaches which took place in the railway because of the stagnated water on the one side and insufficient opening has been provided into the bridges. And sometimes when sufficient action has not been taken, sufficient bonding is not there regarding this breaches, then it may result into some severe accident, or there may be loss of the life or loss of the, you can say, the financial losses to the organizations. So we will just go through some important terms which are required to be used in this presentation. One is called the design discharge. So what is the design discharge? Basically, it is the estimated discharge. It is a discharge we are estimating for the purpose of designing a bridge or any apprentices. It may be for the deciding the span, or it may be deciding the how big is to be constructed, the guide bunk or other things. But discharge we are using for designing these things, it is called the design discharge. And another important thing is the afflux. Whenever we are deciding, when we are calculating the design discharge, when we are deciding the span opening, then afflux should also be taken into the account. We know that always when there is any free flow is there, and we are constructing this waterway, definitely it is going to reduce, there will be increase in the velocity just near to the bridge as compared to the whatever the velocity on the upstream side. So there will be gaining of the kinetic energy just under the bridge. So this gaining energy of the upstream side, and that is relating to the heading of the water on the upstream side. So that is called the reflex. Whenever we are calculating the opening, when we are deciding the opening, or we are deciding any clearance or freeboard with respect to this water level, always we have to take into the account the afflux. Another thing is which is important for planning of the bridge with respect to the design discharge, that is the freeboard and the clearance. In the railway generally we are talking about the freeboard, that it's called the just on the approach of the bridges, whatever the formation level is there with respect to the highest water level in the bridge, and the difference between the highest water level in the bridge and the formation level on the approach of the bridge, that is called the freeboard. And difference between the highest water level in the bridge and the, you can say, the bottommost part of the superstructure, that is called the clearance. And these are two things are required when we are deciding the span arrangement based on the design discharge. That will be covered by Mr. Goyal in his lecture in the detail. So what are the relevance of the design discharge for any person who are involved in the planning of the bridges? So these are the things which are being governed by the design discharge. One is the bridge waterway. Then foundation. Another thing is when we are deciding the foundation level, where the foundation is to be laid and how strong is the foundation. Foundation level is depend on the SCOR level, and SCOR is indirectly SCOR level also depend on the waterway, not the waterway, and indirectly it is depend on the design discharge also. And in the approach of the bridges, when we have protection work is to be done, then all these protection work are being designed based on the design discharge only. The factor which are deciding how big is this protection is to be constructed, it will depend on the design discharge in the. And as discussed earlier, that the FLEX is to be considered at the time of deciding the freeboard and the clearance. And all these three things, this FLEX is, how the FLEX is to be calculated, it depends on the velocity. And velocity is directly independent on the opening of the span, as we know that the Q is equal to the A into B. That is the area of the flow and the velocity. And that FLEX is governed by the A and B velocity, B also. So FLEX is also indirectly governed by the design discharge. Freeboard, it depends on the how big is opening is there, how what is the highest level of the water in the under the bridge, and the vertical clearance. So these are things which are governed by the design discharge. So this is a provision given in the Indian Railway Substructure Code that for designing, for estimating the design discharge, what the recurrence interval is to be followed, what is the probable period of the flood is to be followed. So it is given in the Indian Railway Substructure Code that probable recurrence interval of the 50 years should be followed. However, in the case of the important bridges, suppose we are considering that they are the bridges to be constructed for the strategic line, where we are not able to compromise the interest on of the traffic for any period of the time, then we can think about the big, and we are ready to expend any type of the finance to construct that of the bridge. Suppose the bridge is to be constructed just near to the border, China border or Pakistan border, we are not able to compromise the interest into the traffic, then we can think about of constructing the big bridge which are having the recurrence interval of the 100 years. And for the small important lines, maybe for the sidings, or maybe we can say the minor road where we are ready to compromise the interruption for the frequent intervals, then we can think about of constructing the bridge which are having the design discharge calculated based on the lower recurrence interval, less than the 50 years. But generally for the road constructions, for the bridge constructions, we have to follow the flood estimation having the recurrence interval of the 50 years. So how this discharge is to be calculated? So one of the best method is the actual data. If you are having the sufficient data where the bridge is to be constructed, suppose there is any river and we want to construct the bridge here, any station, at this station we have the sufficient data has been recorded for the last 50 years or 100 years, then we can think about, we have the data, we can work out that which flood is having the probability of occurring once in the 50 years, then there is no problem. Another method is the statistical method. In this method, suppose we don't have any data for the more than the 50 years, we have the data for a sufficient longer period, it may be for the 20 years or 30 years, then there we can develop the numerical models, statistical models can be developed, and we can extrapolate the discharge, we can work out the flood which are having the recurrence interval of the 50 years. That is another method if you are having the not having the data for more than the 50 years, but sufficient data is available. But this practically is very difficult to having the data for the 50 years at the particular location. Otherwise, until and unless we are having the we have to construct the bridge for the replacement, or we are widening the road, or we are constructing any new line just adjoining to the existing line. Otherwise, it is very difficult to have the data for the sufficient longer period at the locations where the bridge is to be constructed. So there is another method, that is a unit hydrograph. This is basically unit hydrograph, which basically is the relation, conversion of the rainfall into the runoff. So generally all over the India, so many rain gauge stations are there where we are having the sufficient data over the period of time has been recorded. Rain gauge stations are there. We have the data, rainfall data is here. And that IMD, Indian Meteorological Department, they have developed so many charts which are showing that the various probable rainfall at the particular stations. So based on that rainfall, we can, if we are having the relations between the rainfall and the runoff, then we can work out the runoff for the rainfall, which is corresponding to the having the recurrence interval of 50 years, then we can work out the discharge. But for that purpose, we must have the data at the locations, rainfall data at the locations where bridge is to be constructed. And this is also one of the impractical possibility. So then next is the synthetic hydrograph. Basically, this is the, you can say this is advanced version. We will not say the advanced version. This basically when the we are not having the rainfall data at the locations where the bridge is to be constructed and the relations between the rainfall and runoff at that locations. Then this is the method which is governed, which has been drawn based on the flood estimation reports. All India has been divided into the 26 submetallurgical hydrometallurgical subzones. And for each subzones, this is flood estimation reports has been developed. It is a joint work of, you can say it is a joint work of the Indian Meteorological Department, Ministry of Surface Transport, Indian Railways, and the CWC. So suppose in the submetallurgical zone, this is we are thinking that they are behaving in the having a similar pattern of the rainfall and the runoff. So in this submetallurgical zone, suppose we are having the 5-6 stations where we are having the data for the rainfall, and this data has been correlated with respect to the whatever the flow is there in the river channels in this submetallurgical zones.
Recording stopped.
So similar behavior have been worked out in the river channels, and the rainfall data is available for the this
recording in progress
zones. Then depending on the catchment area of the bridge site, we can develop this unit hydrograph for that catchment area. That is called the synthetic hydrograph. We will discuss them in detail in the forthcoming slides. And there are some empirical formula has been developed all over the world. There is one empirical formula in the Indian Railway also, that is called the RVF 16 method. That is applicable for the small catchment area. In the Indian Railway, we are following that if the catchment area is less than the 25 square kilometer, then this empirical formula can be used for working out the design discharge. Basically, when the catchment area is small catchment area is there, then the possibility of variation is very less. So we can follow this empirical method. But otherwise, if the catchment area is very large, then we must go for the synthetic hydrograph method. So two things are required for working out the design discharge, and one is called the physical parameter, physiographical parameter, and other is called the hydrometallurgical parameters. One thing is there, suppose this is the river, we want to construct the bridge here, then this is the area which are contributing, anything is falling in this area, any drop of the water is falling in this area is contributing towards the discharge at this location. So this is the physical parameters of the catchment area. We will discuss about it. There is maybe the area, the slope, generally you can say the slope or behavior of the catchment area, whatever the soil is there in the catchment area, and how long is the stream is there, how much time is required for the water to travel from this far away point to this bridge locations. So all these are all the physical parameters. And in addition to this, other parameters which are required for working of the day and discharge, that is called the hydrometallurgical parameter. That is basically, you can say that how much intensity of the rainfall is there, what type of the rainfall is there, duration of the rainfall, all the other hydrometallurgical parameters. So two types of the parameters are required for working out the day and discharge. One is called the physical parameter, and another is called the hydrometallurgical parameter. So catchment, as we know that we have the contour maps, and suppose this is the, we want to construct the bridge here. So this is the basically, you can say this is the watershed, sometimes it is called the catchment area or watershed area. This is called the watershed boundary. Any drop of the water is falling in this area will result into the discharge at this locations. Anything is falling beyond this line will not come to that point of interest. So it depends on the where the location, where the bridge is to be constructed, and we have to draw the lines along the ridge lines. And these ridge lines can be drawn properly if you are having the contour maps. Suppose you want to construct the bridge, then the watershed line is a red line. If we want to construct the bridge here, then the watershed line will be the blue line only. So physical parameters, there are the five types of physical parameter. One is the area. Okay, this is the area of the watershed area, watershed catchment area. Then CG of the catchment area. Basically, CG is basically center of gravity of the area. Okay, then the length of the longest stream. If there is any stream is there, then we have to work out the how much length of the stream is for the farthest point to the point of the interest. That is length is called the length of the longest stream. Then next parameter is the LG. That is the length of the longest stream from nearest to the CG to the bridge site. So corresponding to the CG, we will draw a line near to the on the longest stream, and from this locations to the point of interest, the bridge site, that is called the LG. And another thing is the which will decide the velocity of the flow of the water, that is the statical slope of the stream. So generally we have seen that this catchment area is generally they are having that watershed area having the ridge lines, and the from ridge lines the water is lowering towards the bridge side. So the equated slope of this stream bed slope, or basically you can say the equated slope of the bed of the stream, is called the statical stream slope S. So these are the five physical parameters which are required for working out the design discharge. As we know the contour, we will not discuss in the detail. Everybody is, I think, all people are aware of the how the contours are being drawn, or how we are working out this ridge lines and other things. Always there is a turn into the contour lines. They are just showing the, basically it is the ridge line or valley line. So we have to connect all these lines. They are deciding the boundary of the catchment area. And for getting this contour maps, we have to approach to the Survey of India. The Survey of India has developed, they are having the topo, they are called the topo sheets. So depending on the latitude and longitude where the bridge is to be constructed, we have to work out the latitude and longitude of that bridge locations. And in particular, and which topo sheet is to be referred, it depends upon the latitude and longitude of the bridge. So earlier days we have to collect these, they are coming in the hard copies only, but nowadays the soft copies are available. And there is the site is called the, just a minute, yeah. That is, the site is called the soinakshe.uk.gov.in. This is the Survey of India site, where you can download, you have to register one time, and then you can download the these topo sheets for the you can use it. And if that is generally the normally the contour intervals of 20 meters, if you want the detailed contour that is having the small intervals, then you have to approach to the remote sensing center of the Hyderabad, then you can collect it with the approval of the government. And for working out these physical parameters, you can use the site that is called the Bhuvan. That is the GIS platform. Nowadays, number of the GIS platform is available for working out the physical parameter, but QIGS is there, one of the so many American GIS platform is there. So some of them you can use without any paying any money, and some of the paid site is there where we can work out in the details. If you want to work out for the Indian aspect, then you can refer, this site is called the Bhuvan. That is a GIS platform developed by the ISRO, and you have to register it on this site. You can register it through email and through the mobiles, and then you can utilize this site. And all the details are available, all the watershed areas are available on this site. This is the Bhuvan 2, you have to go to the Bhuvan 2D, then you have to select the base hydrology. In the base hydrology, that watershed area of all the streams are available here. Just you have to mention your point of interest, that is a bridge location site, longitude and latitude of that is to be entered. And then you can, all the catchment area will be marked on this Bhuvan site. And now the additional facility has been incorporated, that they could directly, all the that area, L and everything can be worked out directly on the Bhuvan site. Here are some screenshot of the Bhuvan site. Suppose we mark the locations of this particular, this is an example of the Nagpur-Sevagram line. So this is my point of interest. Then this is the channels which are contributing to the area. Then you can mark the watershed area. then all these physical parameters can be calculated. So, but in the recently, in the 5-6 months back, they have incorporated that it, nowadays it doesn't require to mark the this catchment area manually. Just you mark the location of the bridge, they, then there the features are available. That catchment area will be marked automatically on the site. It will take 5 to 10 minutes. Then that you can work out all the details automatically. Okay. Otherwise, you can mark it manually on the topo sheet, and then you can calculate it. Okay. So this is regarding the physical parameters. The 5 physical parameters is to be worked out for calculating the day and discharge. Next is the that hydrometeorological parameters. So as we know that India has been divided to the 7 hydrometeorological zones and further divided to the 26 sub zones. So basically there are the 7 zones. One is basically on the north side, you can say this is the 1A, 1B, 1C. So basically this is the one on the north side. Mostly this is the one. 2 is basically it is the Brahmaputra, that is for the Ganga, that is north Brahmaputra and the south Brahmaputra. So for the Brahmaputra and the basin, it is the area 2. And the 3 is basically in the central India, that is the Sabarmati, Mahi, Narmada, then Mahanadi, Upper Godavari, Lower Godavari, Indravati, Krishna. All these central portion is basically in the 3 submetallurgical zone. And 4 is basically, it is basically eastern subcoast, eastern coast. And 5 is the western subcoast. And 6 is for the Andaman Nicobar, and 7 is for the Jammu Kashmir. So it is the flood estimation report has been developed for all these 26 submetallurgical zone. It is a joint work of the CWC, RDSO, IMD, and the Ministry of Surface Transport. Now we will discuss about the synthetic hydrograph method. How this hydrograph is, unit hydrograph is to be developed for the particular location, and then how to work out the day and discharge by after developing this unit hydrograph. So what is a unit hydrograph? What is a hydrograph? Hydrograph is basically it is the relation between the discharge in the river and with respect to the time. Okay. So this is basically is the discharge. We are recording the discharge here with the time how it is varying. Okay. So if there is no rainfall, then will be constant discharge. But in the upstream side, if there is a rainfall, there is a rainfall is there, then there is a buildup of the discharge. There will be increase in the discharge, and subsequently, after the when the rainfall has been stopped, then everything has been passed from this location, then it will reach to the original discharge level. So with the rainfall, there is an increase in the discharge, that is called the relation between the rainfall, how this runoff is being increased in the river basin, or you can say at the point of interest, it is called the in hydrograph. So it is commonly includes the base flow, that is the base flow before the start of the rainfall. Then during after the rainfall, how increase wind build up of the runoff is direct, that is called the direct runoff. This is a build up of the runoff because of the rainfall. So it is the base flow plus direct runoff. So what is the unit hydrograph? It is basically is a hypothetical hydrograph. We are assuming that suppose there is no base flow, and upstream side there is the unit rainfall. Suppose there is a unit rainfall. Suppose this is a, we can say it is a 1 centimeter rainfall. So if in over the catchment area, complete catchment area, if there is a 1 centimeter rainfall for a unit duration, for the sake of convenience, we are considering that the unit that unit time is considering, we are considering as a 1 hour. So suppose there is 1 centimeter rainfall for the 1 hour over the complete catchment area, then how this runoff will be there in the at the point of interest? That is called the unit hydrograph. It is a hypothetical response. So with the increase in the when the rainfall is started, there is a zero discharge. With the rainfall, then increase, there is an increase in the runoff, and of this is called the rising limb, and this is called the falling limb of the hydrograph. So some of the basic concept, some of the basic assumptions behind the unit hydrograph is that Storms of the equal duration will produce a runoff hydrograph or with the equivalent time base regardless the intensity of the rainfall. So we are considering that suppose there is a 1 centimeter rainfall, this is called the time base. So if the 1 centimeter rainfall is there for the 1 hour and this build up of the rainfall is started at 0 hour and it will end at the TV. This is the time period. So if there is a rainfall instead of the 1 centimeter, if there is a rainfall of the 2 centimeter in the 1 hour, then this base period will remain the same. There will not be any increase in the base period. This is the first assumption. Okay. And another assumption is that the ordinates of the direct surface runoff hydrograph of the common base time are proportional to the effective rainfall. This means that suppose this is the hydrograph for the 1 centimeter rainfall. If the intensity is 2 centimeter per hour, then we have to proportionally increase the. So the next hydrograph will be the to all the ordinates of the 2 centimeter rainfall will having the 2 times of the unit hydrographs. So this is another assumption. And the hydrograph of the direct surface runoff of the drainage basin due to given pattern of the effective rainfall will not change over the time. So these flood estimation report has been developed 10 years, 15 years back. Some modification has been carried out over the period of time, but generally there is a they are applicable for the 10 to 15 years. So in the intervening period, it has been assumed that there will not be any change in the behavior of the catchment area. Okay, if any urbanization is there or any deforestation is there, there will not be any change in the behavior of the unit hydrograph. So suppose this is a unit hydrograph of 1 centimeter is the blue one. If the rainfall of the having the intensity more than the 1 centimeter, then we have to multiply by the x2. It will be the having the higher ordinates. If the intensity is lower than the 1 centimeter, then we have to multiply by the x2 and they are having the lower ordinates. And suppose we are having that rainfall for a period of 3 hours, then how to work out the total hydrograph? So this is the unit hydrograph. So we can break this 3 hour rainfall in the 1 centimeter rainfall for the each hour. So we can have the first unit hydrograph one that been started here. Another unit hydrograph number two batch is started here. Next unit hydrograph which is starting at the after the 2 hours. So there are 3 unit hydrographs, 1, 2, and 3. Then suppose in the first hour we are having the intensity of the 1.5 centimeter and the next hour we are having the intensity of the 2 centimeter and the next hour we are having the intensity of the 1.25 centimeter. So first unit hydrograph number 1 is to be multiplied by the 1.5 centimeter, 1.5 times of the 1. Then ordinate of the number hydrograph number 5 will having the 2 times of the unit hydrograph number 2 and the unit hydrograph number 6 that will having the ordinates that is having the multiple of the 1.25 times of the unit hydrograph number 3. So these are the hydrographs because of the rainfall of 1.5 centimeter, 2 centimeter, 1.5 centimeter in the 3 hours. If we add up all the ordinates of the 4, 5 and 6, then we will get the total hydrograph because of this total rainfall in the 3 hours over the catchment area. So blue one is basically the total hydrograph. And this is the peak discharge. We are looking for the design discharge. This is the peak discharge of this hydrograph. This is not the unit hydrograph, this is the total hydrograph. Okay, so this is the way of using the synthetic hydrograph. Once we develop the synthetic hydrograph, then it can be utilized for any type, any intensity of the rainfall, for any duration of the rainfall, for working out the total discharge. So why this synthetic hydrograph? As we already discussed earlier, that unit hydrograph can be developed if the site-specific current concurrent rainfall and runoff data is available for the 5 to 8 years, but it is very difficult to collect the details at the bridge locations for 5 to 8 years, then we have to. Request the participant to please switch off the microphone. So we can develop this in a hydrograph by referring it to the flood estimation report that is called the synthetic hydrograph. So major steps involved in the working out the design discharge in the synthetic hydrograph is the first step is to develop the synthetic hydrograph based on the flood estimation report. Then next step is once the hydrograph has been developed, once we have got the hydrograph, Then next thing is required that we are looking for the rainfall which are resulting into the maximum discharge. So we have to work out the storm durations. What duration will lead to the maximum discharge and what intensity will lead to the discharge for which bridge is to be constructed. So next step is to work out the design storm duration and the intensity of the rainfall. And when there is a rainfall, there is some losses is there. Maybe losses in the form of the evaporations or losses. Maybe some of the rainfall is not contributing to direct runoff. Some of it is going into the in the ground. So that is called the loss rate is to work out. That is to be this loss is to be deducted from the rainfall that will give the effective rainfall. So loss rate is to work out. Base flow, whatever the direct runoff is there, we have to add into the base flow. That will give the total discharge at the bridge locations. Base flow is there. Base flow is the flow which is there. This is the perennial flow in the river, and that is to be added to the direct runoff. And rainfall excess is not only, it is only the rainfall minus loss rate, that is effective rainfall. And effective rainfall is only contributing to the direct runoff. And then we can work out the total hydrograph by adding up all these hydrograph as been discussed earlier. So these are the steps involved in the working out the discharge based on the synthetic hydrograph method. So to draw any curve like this, we require at least three lines. This is just similar to the what we are carrying out in the earthwork OMC or that MDD or OMC ka jo hota hai, just the similar type of the curve is there for the init hydrograph. They are having the similar shape is generally is there. At least three points are required, starting point, end point, and one of the point is there. But so many curves can be drawn by drawing the by connecting these points. So if we have the number of the points, then we can a realistic curve can be drawn. So in the all the flood estimation report, there are the five, you can say there are the seven points are required to draw this synthetic hydrograph. One is the starting point, this is the next this is the highest point, the peak discharge point, this is the end of the direct runoff point, that is the TB, and in between there are the four additional point has been mentioned in the flood estimation report. This is called the W50 W75. Basically, this is the width of the unit hydrograph. Suppose this is a total discharge. This is the total discharge QP. So this is basically 75% of the total discharge, and this is the 50% of the total discharge, a peak discharge, not the total discharge. It is 50% of the peak discharge. So this is the width of the hydrograph at the 50% of the peak discharge, and this is the width of the hydrograph at the 75% of the peak discharge. So we will get the width distance between these two points. But how to fix the point? So this is called the WR50 and WR75. WR50 is just showing the distance from here to the towards the rising limb side at the 50% of the peak discharge. At the 50% ordinates, this is the distance of this point from the peak discharge points location. This is called the WR50, and similarly this is called the WR75. So these are the seven points, and for these seven points, based on the analysis, based on the data collected over the period of the time, some empirical formula have been given in the flood estimation reports. This is the TP, time taken from the center of the rainfall axis to the duration of the peak discharge. What is the time? This is the T. Suppose this is the 1 hour rainfall. So time sir, the CG of this rainfall will be 30 centimeter. So from here, CG of this rainfall to the peak discharge, when the peak discharge will occur from the CG of the rainfall, that is called the TP. So for the TP, is the formula has been given. It will depend on the physical parameter of the catchment area, length of the longest stream, length of the longest stream from CG to point of the locations, and the equated slope of terrain, that is the bed slope of stream. Okay, so all these things will depend on the physical parameter of the catchment area. So these are the physical parameters. This is common to the all flood estimation report. Only difference is there in the flood estimation report, the numerical values are depend upon the hydrological, that's the meteorological zones. Otherwise, they will depend on the physical parameters, length, quoted slope, length of the longest stream, and the length of the longest stream from the CG to CG, from near to the CG to the bridge locations. But numerical values are different for the different subzones. For the Kaveri zone, it is of 0.553, and for the maybe the other Godavari, it may be of 0.45, or depend. That has been worked out over the period of the time by collecting the details. So first we have to calculate the TP, and the other parameters will depend on the TP only. There is a peak discharge per unit Qmec per second, per unit area, that is the discharge Qmec per unit area. So basically it is the total peak discharge divided by the catchment area A. It is again is the physical parameters. So QP will be worked out, then W50, W75, WR50, WR75, they will depend on the QP. So we can work out all these details. And TB is the base period. And TM is the time of the rainfall access to the, that is the TP plus, TM is basically is the, nothing is the TP plus CG of the, half of the CG, half of the duration of the rainfall. And QP is the total discharge, that is the QP into A. So once we have calculated all these things, then we can draw as into the hydrograph. Once this hydrograph has been drawn, then we can utilize this hydrograph to draw the total hydrograph. And this is a method of working out the equated slope. It is nothing, it is not the average. Suppose this is the terrain. It is not the slope of connecting these two points, it is the equated slope. It's a weighted average. We will work out in the small. Okay, and then we will add up. So this is the table of how to calculate this equated slope. This is to be used for working out the TP and the QP and other things. This is a way of working out the, basically this is just the area under this total bed slope and area under that equated slope SE will same. This is we are working out. First, we have to calculate these physical parameters L, LC and SCQ. Once this has been calculated, we can work out this all these parameters for to draw the synthetic hydrograph. Once this synthetic hydrograph has been drawn, okay, we have drawn these 7 points and we have drawn this synthetic hydrograph by connecting all these 7 points. Another important thing is there, whatever synthetic hydrograph has been drawn, this is basically the hydrograph, this discharge is because of the 1 cm rainfall for the 1 hour durations. So suppose this is a catchment area and this area is A and this is a 1 cm rainfall over the complete catchment area. So that should be the volume. What should be the volume? This is the area into the height of the water. Height of the water will be the 1 cm. So this is a theoretical volume. Okay, so this is a theoretical volume. If A is the square kilometer, then we will convert into the meter, and the, again the centimeter has been converted to the meter. So this is the total volume of the water under this unit hydrograph. If we add up all the ordinates of the unit hydrograph, that is the volume. Here we are on the y-axis, we are plotting Q. On the x-axis, we are plotting the time. So Q into T is the volume. So under the unit hydrograph, whatever the volume is there, that should be theoretically equal to this volume. This is a theoretical volume. Okay. But suppose, after connecting these 7 points, we have drawn the one hydrograph, and the volume under this hydrograph is coming more than this, our theoretical volume, then we have to reduce. Suppose these are the fixed point, WR50, this is a peak point, this is a fixed point, all these are the fixed point. This is called the rising limb, this is the falling limb. And generally rise is quite steep and the falling is quite gradual, falling limb is quite gradual. Okay, so this has been given in the all the flood estimation report, that if the your volume under the hydrograph is more than the theoretical volume, then we have to reduce the this area under the unit hydrograph. And this can be reduced from after this W55, it can be reduced beyond by making the adjustment beyond the W50. So we can make the adjustment from this location to the TV locations. This volume can be adjusted. And on the other end, if the volume under the unit hydrograph is less than the theoretical volume, then we have to increase this ordinates of the falling limb beyond the W50. So this is the way of make it to the equal to the theoretical volume. Okay, once the unit hydrograph has been drawn, the next step is how to calculate this design storm. What duration of the rainfall related to the maximum discharge? So this has been given in the all the flood estimation report, that the duration of the rainfall equivalent to the 1.1 times of the TP will be considered as the storm duration. As we know that, suppose this is the catchment area. Okay, so time taken by the rainfall, any drop of the water from the farthest point to travel to this location, it is called the time of concentration. Okay, so in the small catchment area, it is just equivalent to the time of concentration. So it has been found that if the duration of the rainfall is more than the whatever time is required to reach to the peak discharge, what is the TP? TP is basically is from the CG of the rainfall to reach to the peak of the discharge. Peak of the discharge means that each and every drop of the water falling on the catchment area is contributing to the discharge. So basically it is, we can say that it is just equivalent to the time of concentration. So it has been taken 1.1 times of the this distance TP. Then estimation of the point rainfall. So once the duration has been found, once we have decided the duration of the rainfall, then next step is how to find out this rainfall for this duration. Generally in the flood estimation report, we are having the graph or chart where we are having the 24 hours rainfall data. We are having the, these are the lines connecting the rainfall locations, having the generally for the duration of the 24 hours. So we have to convert this 24 hour rainfall into the particular, suppose my DD is coming is 8 hours. So this 24 hour rainfall is to be converted into the 8 hour durations. Data are available for the 24 hour rainfall. So the method has been given in the flood estimation report, how to convert this 24 hour rainfall into the 8 hours rainfall. One more thing is there, this whatever the data has been given, that is the point rainfall. This is the data which has been recorded at the particular locations. But we having the catchment area, suppose our catchment area is 2000 square kilometers. We can't assume that whatever the rainfall is there at this location, it will be uniformly over the complete area. Okay, so this is called the point rainfall, and this is to be converted into the area rainfall. By multiplying the suitable factors, this point rainfall is to be converted into the aerial rainfall. So first we are talking about the point rainfall. So first thing is to convert the 24 hour point rainfall into the duration, TD duration rainfall. That is the first step. Once it has been converted, then we have to convert into the aerial rainfall by multiplying to the suitable factors. So for this purpose, the different table has been given in the flood estimation reports. Just a minute. This type of the tables are available in the flood estimation report. These are showing the basically 24 hours rainfall. This is for the example for the lower Godavari regions. This is the 24 hour rainfalls. Suppose we want to construct the, this is my latitude and longitude of the base. So we can say that is the 220 millimeter rainfall, which are having the recurrence intervals of the once in the 50 years. So once in the 50 years, there is a 220, once in the 50 years, this rainfall has been crossed beyond the 220 mm. So this is only for the 24 hours. Now we have to convert into the 8 hours or 7 hours. So this type of the chart has been given into the flood estimation report. So this is showing the ratio, how to convert. This is for the 10 years, similar data is available for the 50 years. So suppose we have to convert, this is the duration of the rainfall. For the 8 hours, it is multiplying factor is coming 0.75. So if we multiply the 220 by 0.705, so that will give the 8 hours rainfall, which having the probability of occurrence once in the 50 years. So that is the point rainfall at that location. Now this point rainfall is to convert into the aerial rainfall, and this will depend on the catchment area and the durations. Okay, so suppose we want to convert into the, this is the 3 hours rainfall. this is a catchment area in the square kilometers, and this is the duration of the rainfall. Suppose for the 3 hours, we have the catchment area of 67 kilometers. My catchment area is 67 square kilometers. So we have to interpolate between the 50 and the 100. On the other hand, suppose my duration is coming 3.5, so we have to interpolate in between this. Otherwise, for the 3 hours, we can directly interpolate between these two values. So this is the percentage of the rainfall that is to be that is the multiplying factor to convert the point rainfall into the aerial rainfall. So this is multiplying factor is coming for the 3 hours catchment area of the 67 square kilometer that is falling between the 100 and the 50, and for this interpolation factor is coming 0.913. Okay, so we got the unit hydrograph, we got the duration of the rainfall, and we got the total rainfall. This is giving the total rainfall over the period of time. One more thing is there. Suppose we are assuming that this is a rainfall of this over the period of 8 hours or whatever the TD is there, we can't assume that this is the uniform rainfall will be there. It cannot be for the over the period of the 8 hours that having the constant intensity. There will be the variable intensity over the period of the time. So for this purpose, another table has been given, the flood estimation report, where we can convert the total duration of the rainfall into the intensity over the period of the time. And this is given the form of the cumulative rainfall. Maybe the there will be any 1 hour, it is the 62%, then in the 2 hours, 75%, then over the 3 period, 83%. So this is the total rainfall which has been distributed over the period of the 7 hours. Okay, so then after working out this intensity, we can work out over the period of the time what will be the intensity. Then we have to arrange this intensity in such a way that result to the maximum discharge. And then by, as we have seen in the earlier example, how this 3 hours rainfall is in the total hydrographs, so we can add up all the unit hydrographs over the period of over the leg of the 1 hours. Okay, then after working out this intensity, we have to deduct the losses to work out the effective rainfall that result to the maximum direct runoff. So intensity over that has been distributed over the period of the 8 hours or 7 hours, that is equivalent to TD. For the hourly losses to be deducted, then the effect, whatever the effective rainfall is there, for that we will work out the hydrograph by multiplying it ordinates of the unit hydrograph. Okay, then we can add up all the ordinates with the lag of the 1 hour each. This is the 1 hour each. Okay, then we can work out the total discharge. So this is the way of using the unit hydrograph, synthetic hydrograph, for working out the design discharge. So this is one of the example. Because of shortage of time, I'm just skipping this example. You can go through it. I will share the presentation. So this is one of the method to be used for the catchment area if the larger catchment area is there. And the assumptions for using the synthetic hydrograph, it has been assumed that 50 years certain period of storm rainfall will produce the 50 years flood. What is the design discharge? It is the design discharge is the flood which are having the recurrence of the 50 years. So what we are assuming that this is equivalent to the rainfall which are having the recurrence into the 50 years will result into the flood which are having the recurrence into the 50 years. It may be, but this is the assumption. Another thing is that the catchment used for the analysis will be treated homogeneous. If the catchment area is of the to the tune of the 2000 square kilometer or 1000 square kilometer, it is very difficult to assume is the that having the homogeneous nature, but it has been assumed. And another thing is the generalized conclusion regarding the waste flow loss rate. Some of the empirical formulas has been given in the flood estimation report for working out the waste flow or working out the loss rate. And again, the submetallurgical zone. So if you are talking about the three of Godavari basin or Kaveri basin, they are the quite a large sub basin is there. And we can't assume that whatever the losses is there in the Hyderabad may can be applicable to the Pune. But this is assumption. We are assuming the everything that waste flow and the rate that the rate of the losses are considering the same over the submetallurgical zone. So these are three assumptions behind the synthetic hydrograph method. And there are a number of the empirical methods available all over the world. One of the method which are we are mostly using in the railway, that is the RBF-16. Basically, it is this empirical method has been drawn based on the synthetic hydrograph only, but because of the smaller catchment area, variation is very small. So this is the formula. Similar type of the formula is available in the some of the books also. 0.278 CI50A. This 0.758 is nothing. It is the one of the factor. C is the coefficient of the runoff. All the rainfall is not converting into the runoff. So one of the factor is required to convert to work out the basically to set the relations between the rainfall and the runoff. A is the catchment area of the catchment area in the square kilometer. I50 is the 50-year rainfall intensity. This is the intensity of the rainfall having the recurrence interval of the once in the 50 years. So this is the empirical formula. So always when we are using the empirical formula, we just take care about the units. A is, value of the A is to be put up into the square kilometer. I50 is to be put up into the millimeter per hour. And for runoff coefficient, this is the how to work out the runoff coefficient. It will depend on the behavior of the soil of the catchment area and the rainfall intensity and the duration of the rainfall. So there is another relation has been given in the RBF-16, that is the XRF.F 0.2, and this is R is basically the what has been discussed, the convert the point rainfall into the aerial rainfall. It depend on the duration and the catchment area. So B have the similar type of the chart is available in the flood estimation report or RBF-16 report. It may be the 50 as 1 hour rainfall durations or 50 as 24 hour durations, and we have to convert into the our durations, that is the intensity of required durations. And these are the value of the X. How to work out this X runoff coefficient will depend on this behavior of the soil. So for the sandy soil, it is the most of the things will go into the ground and less thing is will be rest rainfall will go into the runoff. On the other end, for the barren land, most of the things will be converted into the runoff. And this is the value of how to work out the aerial reduction factor. It will depend on the catchment area and the duration of the rainfall. If the duration of the rainfall is more and the area is small, then the we can assume that the behavior will be more homogeneous or uniform behavior is there. Our duration is very small and the area is large, then the non-uniformity, possibility of non-uniformity is more. And how to work out the duration? As we have to work out the time of concentration. Here it is called the time of concentration. So working out the time of concentration, there is another formula that is called the Bhatnagar formula has been given there in the RBF-16 report. It will depend on the length of the stream and the distance between the, that is the distance between the farthest point and the bridge locations and the level difference between these two points. Okay, so this is the Bhatnagar formula. As we know that the level difference is more than the water will travel at the higher speed. If the level is difference is less, then it will travel at the lower speed. So that's why H is in the denominator and the length is in the length. Longer stream will result requires a longer time, so it is on the numerator. So this is a Bhatnagar formula. Similarly, another formula is there, the Francis-Williams formula is there. Here the equated slope has been taken into the account instead of the difference between the levels. Equated slope has been taken into the account. Similar step is to adopt it. Once the time of concentration has been that is the duration of the rainfall has been worked out, then we have to work out the intensity of the rainfall of that duration by converting to the 24 hour rainfall into the that duration. So similar type of the chart has been given to convert the 24 hour rainfall into the required duration of the rainfall. Okay, so this empirical formula can be used for the smaller catchment area. And in my presentation, what I've been covered, that I've taken from the substructure code of Indian Railway and RBF-16 report that has been developed by the RDSO and the flood estimation report that has been developed by the CWC Ministry, that Ministry of Surface Transport, RDSO, and the Indian Meteorological Department. So this is my from my side. If any queries or questions are there, questions are welcome. It is very difficult to cover all these things in this short durations.
Okay. That's right. Thank you, Professor Sanjay Khare.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for your session on this bridge hydraulics and methods of estimation of design discharge. Really, you have tried to explain in the method in such a detail, and as that was expected. And as you right now said, it is really very difficult to cover such a huge topic in such a short period of time. But I think you have nearly touched all the aspects.
Yeah.
Really, means you started with the recurrence period, the probability of occurrence of the flood taking as 50 years. Then how openings provided is important in the design and planning of the spans of bridges. You started with the very basics, that is, as definitions of the specific terms like design discharge, efflux freeboard, how they are relevant in the design discharge. And then you started with the estimation of the design discharge based on the substructure code in the Indian Railways. You discussed all the methods, that is based on the actual data, statistical method, unit hydrograph, synthetic hydrograph, and very well explained in detail the method using the unit hydrograph as well as the synthetic hydrograph. So the other thing, that is the example that you showed, that is the stepwise, how you have explained the entire method for the catchment area of about 2500, if I'm not wrong, right?
Yeah,
2500 square kilometer, that you have explained in detail. And not only that, but also for the catchment area less than 25 square kilometer also. So I think you have really covered everything. Thank you very much for your presentation. No, thank you very much.
Thank you, Jyoti.
There are some few questions that have been posed by the participants. If you permit me, we'll take few questions from those.
Definitely.
Yeah. So the first question, is from Avinash Saraf. He's asking, what is generally the clearance between the high flood level and the bottom of the girdle for the bridges in case of national highways?
I'm not aware of the national highway, but in the railway, depend on the basically the opening of the bridges. For the box, no clearance is required. As we know that the box is in determined structures for the box, and no clearance is required. For the arches, it depend on the span of the arches. Okay, so maybe. And for the other bridges, for the roof, for the slab bridges, it depend on the discharge.
Right.
So in the railway, being the substructure code, different types of guidelines have been given in the substructure code in the railway. So depending on the discharge, depending on the opening, and the for the box bridges, nothing is required. No clearance is required.
Next question is posed by PSD Naidu. I'll just read his question. Design discharge calculation is having any effect on the surface of riverbed, that is boulder surface, soil surface, in addition to the slope of riverbed? So in the design discharge calculation, I think the nature of the riverbed, that is what he is asking, whether it is a parameter to be considered for design discharge.
Basically, design discharge will not depend on the basically what you are saying, the physical parameters of that bed.
Only
the velocity will be governed by that, and for working out the area of the opening, it is the Q divided by the B. Okay,
right.
So opening will definitely will be governed by the nature of the bed, not the design discharge.
Not the design issue. Okay. Next question is by Dinesh Chauhan. He's saying that, sir, you said about past records of discharge and flood. How these records are being measured? Like at what location, with what instrument? Also, are there any corrections to be applied to the recorded data, or can it be directly used for drawing the unit hydrograph?
Yeah, that can be directly used. But what, suppose in the railway, we have any line has been constructed more than the having the constructed 100 years back, and now we are going for the doubling project. So we have the system of recording every year the what is the highest flood level. So we have such type of data is available, and in the flood estimation report, they have been drawn based on the standard drain gauge stations are there. They are in the river beds. They are recording that highest flood level at that particular measuring stations, and then they correlating it. So corrections are required. Basically, that correction is required for the losses. Everything, all the rainfall is not converted to the right runoff. So for working out this type of the losses, again the empirical formula has been given the flood estimation report. Depending on whatever the data has been collected over the 50 in the past 10 years, 15 years, So all this, this required the continuous recording of the data over a period of the time, and based on that, that has been mentioned in the flood estimations report.
Okay. Next. IRC, CWC, railway codes referred for the discharge calculations. I think this that has come in your last slide.
Yeah. These are the basically flood estimation report. It is available on the CWC site. Anybody can download it, and you can ask for the CWC for the providing such type of the flood estimation report. And solved examples are again given in the flood estimation report. If you permit, I can just I have the one soft copy. Just people can go through it. In the meanwhile, you can ask the question if any question is there. Any question is there again, Jyoti? Any other further question?
Yeah. I think I got a little bit. My connection was unstable, so okay, I didn't get the last thing. Anyway, one more question is there. Yeah. Hydraulic design, you have taken it for 50 years. So hydraulic design period, can it be taken for 100 years? That is the question asked by Gunshilan Radhakrishnan.
Yeah, I told in the at the start of presentation that generally it is the 50 years as suggested by the committee of the engineers made in the 1959 in the chairmanship of Mr. Khosla. For the important bridges, there may be the if we are considering that the superstructure cost, we can't compromise with the damage to the superstructures, then we can go for the higher recurrence intervals. And for the less important bridges, you can go for the lower recurrence intervals.
There's one interesting question by Prasad Chaurikar. He says that if there is a dam or a bhandara in the catchment area, then how to correlate with the design discharge?
Yeah. You have to work out the downstream of the bridges. You have to work out the catchment area that will result into the discharge to the bridge. In addition to that, the discharge, that the design discharge, basically design flow of the dam, that dam is to be added. Okay.
Okay.
I suppose. Just a minute, yeah. So this is your catchment area, and dam has been constructed here. Then we have to work out the discharge for this synthetic hydro for this downstream side of that dam area, plus flow of this design flow of the dam is to be added.
Okay. I think let's take one last question now because we are now short of time. So if we are using sender synthetic unit hydrograph, the coefficients in the subzone were calibrated a long time back, that is way back in 1970s or 80s. So is it advisable to use the same, or should there be any modifications?
Earlier report of 1970 has been modified in the some of the hydrometallurgical zone. They are available on 2000 onwards. So there are a lot of assumptions, and these are the estimations only. So many factors have been encountered, empirical formula, all these, so many factors have been taken. I have seen in the last 25 years working in the railway that whatever the estimations we are carrying out, it is just almost compared to the existing lines, what has been recorded over the period of time for that particular line at that bridge locations. Generally, they are coming to, we can say that is estimation is nearly 10 to 15% higher than the actual that I have seen in the last 20-25 years.
So I think we are mostly covered with all the questions. Other questions were quite minor. So thank you very much, Professor Sanjay Khare, for being there and giving us such a splendid presentation on this bridge hydraulics and design discharge estimation. Thank you very much.